Welcome, everyone. Thank you for coming on this lovely autumn day. I'm going to talk about population growth, development, climate change, and human health, some of the big challenges that we face this century. I'm going to take a historical view of how they are linked and what this might mean for the future. But first, a short video clip from the opening ceremony of the Olympics last year about the Industrial Revolution, where it all
rising dramatically from the ground, the smoking stacks and the chimneys, which of course produced a lot of wealth, but which disfigured many towns and cities and transformed society.
It's definitely my kind of history lesson here. It's such a sound, it's so powerful to look at the Industrial Revolution this way, but if you're at home watching on TV and you've got the remote control, just turn it up a little bit and you'll get a sense of what we're feeling here in the stadium.
Okay, so how many of you saw that last year? How many of you saw the opening ceremony? Were some of you actually in the stadium? Ah, lucky you. I thought it was fantastic. So as the commentator said in that clip, the Industrial Revolution brought great wealth, but also disfigured towns and cities. And these illustrations from the time show the kind of squalid housing that the new factory workers lived in, and these appalling conditions of overcrowding that led to frequent disease outbreaks of cholera and so on. So eventually that led to steps to improve health at the time, and that was really the start of public health as we know it. I think the Industrial Revolution wouldn't have got very far without some improvements in those conditions. So the next slide, I've just summarised some of those key developments in public health, like the sanitary idea. So in 1842, Ernest Chadwick, reported on the sanitary conditions of the labouring population of Great Britain, and he showed that life expectancy was much lower in towns than in the countryside. Not very surprising when you see those pictures or you read Dickens. 1848 was the first Public Health Act, which empowered local boards to deal with environmental rubbish and cesspools and faulty drains and so on. And then in 1858 we had what was called the Great Stink, when literally the stench from the Thames was so appalling that Parliament stopped meeting. And that clearly had to have some remedy, and Joseph Bazalgette, who was the chief engineer of the London Metropolitan Board, started building a network of London sewers, which are still in use today. It was these kind of improvements that led to a big impact on human health. Even though many of the key figures in the sanitary movement believed that diseases were caused by breathing foul air rather than by infection, that mistake didn't really matter in the sense that the end result of cleaning up the environment had this big effect on health. And here you can see this figure shows death rate from TB dropping very steeply long before the TB cause of TB was identified or before any treatment was available. And then there were a series of factories acts which tried to improve health and safety, and there was compulsory immunisation for smallpox. And the combination of these public health improvements reduced death rates and triggered a global demographic transition, which is shown in this stylized diagram. So what is the demographic transition? Well, essentially, it describes how a population with high birth rates and high death rates ends up having low birth rates and low death rates, and in the process becomes much, much larger. So, before the transition starts in this phase, population is fairly stable because on average only two children survive to adulthood to have children, and only two of their children survive to have children, and so on. So the population stays pretty steady. But as the death rate starts to fall, the population grows, and eventually that leads people to decide they want to have smaller families. And so then you get a fall in the birth rate, and eventually you end up with this situation of low birth rates and low death rates, but the population is much bigger. Note that as the fertility rate has already come down, population growth is still increasing. And that's because the improvements in survival a few years earlier mean that there are many more young people having children. And this bit at the bottom here shows what happens to the age structure of the population through this demographic transition. So the blue is boys, conventionally, and the pink is girls. And to begin with, you have this pyramid-shaped structure with lots of young children, but because survival is poor, there are very few elderly. And then as you get this fall in death rate, more people survive, and you get a big bulge here in the adult population, the working age population, relative to old people or children. And then as the fertility rate comes down, this means there are fewer children, and you get an older population, the proportion of old people increases. And this is the situation you arrive at, which is where we are now in developed countries, where the transition first started and took about 2.5 centuries to unfold. In other countries where the transition started in the last century, the pace has been much faster, but it's still unfolding today. And how precisely it unfolds, the timing of these events and the lag between the fall in death rate and birth rate and so on, that is very variable and depends on external conditions like education and family planning, things which would accelerate the fall in birth rate. And that varies very much by region. But the fundamental processes here are the same wherever the demographic transition occurs. So that's fall in death rate, growth in population, and then later on a fall in the fertility rate and aging of the population. You're not going to get tested on this before you leave the lecture theatre, but I think it's useful to have those sort of processes in mind. Okay, and the next slide shows how much the population has increased since the Industrial Revolution and how much more it might increase in the future. So at the beginning, we've got this stable population, and then there's this huge increase in growth in the last century. We're just over 7 billion now, and it only took 12 years for the population to increase from 6 billion in 1998 to 7 billion in 2012. Now, these three curves that project into the future, they are based on UN projections about according to different demographic scenarios. So the medium projection, this blue one, which is regarded as the most likely, assumes that fertility rates will continue to fall in this century like they did in the last century, and would bring us to a population of about 9 or 10 million during this century, and then it would plateau. The difference between this high variant and the medium variant is just half a birth per woman. So the global fertility rate gives the, which is based on the average rate for all women, if it's just one half a birth higher, then you get a much bigger increase in population. And the difference between these two curves, again, is just half a birth. So you can see that birth rate fell from an average of 5 births per woman in 1950 and to 2.5 births per woman in 2005. So that half a birth difference in this century is going to have a huge impact on final population size. And of course, it's not just, that shows the global picture, and it hides a huge amount of regional variation. So virtually all this future growth is going to be in developing countries. In developed countries, as we've seen, where the transition's completed, the population is stable, leaving aside migration. And it's not just the population that's been increasing. This slide shows growth in all kinds of activity since the Industrial Revolution. So this is population. Here we've got water use. This is motor vehicles, telephones, and increase in McDonald's restaurants. So the general picture you can see, more people, more complex societies, and more consumption. Okay, and it's not just those things. Of course, warming of the climate is something we're faced with as well. This shows increase in global temperature, on this axis here. Now this slide looks very complicated, and I believe it is very complicated. These are, again, projections as to what might happen in the future, and these come from the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, and they're based on different scenarios like I showed in the previous graph. Now, the IPCC, which is a group of 500 or more scientists who come together and try and work out what's happening to the climate system, they just produced their fifth report very recently, which some of you may have seen the headlines in the papers. And the conclusions are quite blunt. Warming of the climate system is unequivocal, and it is down to us. Human influence on the climate system is clear. I've just put a few more of the headlines here from that report. The atmosphere and ocean have warmed. Snow and ice have diminished, sea level has risen, and greenhouse gases have increased. The concentration of carbon dioxide has increased by 40% since pre-industrial times, primarily from fossil fuel emissions. The ocean has absorbed about 30% of carbon dioxide, causing ocean acidification. And the various scenarios which I showed you in that slide, they all indicate further warming this century and beyond. So, again, that global picture hides huge regional variation. So this slide brings together several things. It's a bit complicated. So this column is cumulative emissions since the Industrial Revolution, since 1750. This column is emissions in 1 year, 2004. And this is growth in emissions in a short period, 2000 to 2004. And this is the population. So you can see it's been split up into four big emitters, the big individual countries, USA, Japan, China, and India, and then groups of countries that this is former Soviet Union, this is the EU, D1 is the other developed nations, D3 are the least developed nations, and D2 in between. And what you can see is that the developed nations, so orange, red, yellow, and green, these have contributed most to the cumulative emissions, but much less to recent growth in emissions. And it's the opposite picture for developing countries, particularly because of China here, with this huge growth in recent emissions. I think the other thing to say is that these least developed countries, I mean, have had virtually no contribution to climate change whatsoever. There's barely a black line up here. But these are the countries where population is growing fastest and where the need to reduce poverty is greatest. And to date, the model for economic development and bringing people out of poverty is based on industrialization, fossil fuel consumption, which releases tons of carbon dioxide into the atmosphere and messes up the climate system. So it's a real conundrum and brings in this sort of notion of climate justice. What's worse, I think, is that these least developed countries, which have not caused climate change, are likely to be worst affected by the consequences. So this slide shows a map of Bangladesh, which is a poor country. It's densely populated, and it's already heavily prone to disastrous flooding. And this slide shows what happens if the sea level rises 1 meter. A huge area, home to hundreds of millions of people, just gets submerged. So the next few slides I'm going to show you are about how people have responded to all these observations. Concern about population growth is certainly not new. The Reverend Thomas Malthus, in 1798, wrote this famous essay on the principle of population, and he argued that growth in population would always outstrip food production, and that the only ways to keep the two things in check were through natural disaster, or as he put it, misery and vice. He was, after all, the Reverend Malthus. Then in the 1960s and 70s, two books that had a big impact on environmental awareness and on public policy were The Population Bomb by Paul Ehrlich and Limits to Growth from the Club of Rome think tank. The Population Bomb opens with the battle to feed all of humanity is lost. Hundreds of millions of people are going to die of starvation in the 1970s, and nothing we can do now will stop that. Sorry, I don't know why these keep going by themselves. The Limits to Growth was less sensational in style, but it also predicted disastrous collapse of environmental systems due to population growth. So not surprisingly, there was a surge of environmental activism around this time when Friends of the Earth emerged and Greenpeace. And I think these beautiful photos of the Earth from space had something to do with people's increased awareness of the environment. And that really contrasted with all the news at the time about huge oil tankers leaking oil and nuclear disasters and so on. In 1985, the British Antarctica Survey discovered a hole in the ozone layer, which I expect you all remember, and that led to a period of environmental diplomacy with various agreements being signed. And concerns about global warming started to surface at that time as well, and the IPCC was first established in 1998. And I think climate scientists and skeptics and activists have been locked in some pretty fierce controversies since then, arguing about whether climate change is real and whether it's really due to human activity or natural causes. And although that sort of debate hasn't disappeared, it's quite clear that the scientists who work on climate change are sure that it's real and it's really down to humans. The Earth Summit in 1992 was an important event. It led to a couple of UN conventions, the UN Convention Framework on Climate Change and the Convention on Biodiversity. It also put population, reducing poverty, women, the role of women and health as core to sustainable development. So what do we mean by sustainable development? Well, I'm sure someone could give a whole lunchtime lecture on what that means, but essentially it's about being able to meet the needs of the current generation without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their needs. And all these principles have been recently been reiterated in the Rio Plus 20 summit last year. So another debate that's been going on, particularly amongst economists, is about the relationship between population growth and economic growth. Is it bad for economic growth to have more people? And I've sort of summarized about half a century of debate here to three bullet points. So the early studies suggested there was a negative association between population and economic growth. Then the so-called revisionist views rather downplayed the effect of population. And more recent studies have confirmed the adverse economic effects of rapid population growth. So you might ask, why is it that it seems the experts can't make up their mind on this? Well, I'm not an economist, as you've probably guessed. But I think part of the answer is that to begin with, they didn't have enough good data, long-term prospective data, that allowed one to stand back and take the look at the big picture. And I think another reason is that the economic growth after the Second World War was so rapid that the effects of population growth were kind of swamped, they were missed. And so once economic growth slowed down, the adverse effect of population growth became more apparent. And this rather faint graph here, I've taken from Tim Dyson's excellent book on population and development. And you can see here, this is growth in population, this is growth in economy, and you can see the negative relationship here. These two countries are Korea and China. And down here we've got Democratic Republic of Congo and Madagascar. Okay, so one obvious way to influence population growth is through family planning, and this slide shows the changing fortunes of family planning. It didn't start very well. 1916, Margaret Sanger was arrested for opening the first birth control clinic in New York. And Mary Stopes, who opened the first birth clinic in London, near here, she had a pretty tough time from the establishment too. Doctors wanted nothing to do with contraception. It was regarded as rather unsavory. In fact, the Family Planning Service didn't become part of the NHS till 1974. But for the women who came flocking to these clinics, it was a very different matter. They were desperate to have the means of preventing yet another unwanted pregnancy or abortion. 1960s was when the pill and the IUD became widely available. This was the era of modern contraception. And of course the pill transformed women's lives along with free love and peace and women's liberation and so on. And unlike the opposition to contraception in US and Britain, in developing countries faced with these huge growing populations, governments promoted family planning very strongly. And some programs were popular and successful, like in Bangladesh, others were inept or coercive. And things like China's one-child policy and incentives for sterilization in India created a backlash that set the tone for this important meeting in Cairo. This was very different in Cairo. It was about a human rights approach. It was about the concept of sexual health and the right to have a safe and satisfying sex life. However, the message of Cairo faltered, really, and the fortunes of family planning sank, literally, as funding fell by more than a third over this period, despite soaring population growth. Why did funding fall? Well, there were lots of reasons, but the politics of abortion overshadowed discussion of family planning, opposition from the Catholic Church was still strong, and money was diverted to the HIV epidemic. And a low point, a particular low point, was when family planning was altogether missing from the Millennium Development Goals. I'll come on to that in a moment. Nonetheless, global fertility, as I've said, was halved. It was about 5 births per woman in 1950 and 2.5 by 2005. Unfortunately, there's been a big upswing in fortunes of family planning. So last year, we had the London Family Planning Summit, and world leaders and Gates Foundation and so on raised the profile of family planning and talked about the benefits of it, extensive benefits. So we know that through preventing unintended pregnancies and unsafe abortions, contraception has already reduced maternal mortality by 40%, and could prevent 70% of all maternal deaths if all women who needed family planning had access to it. Women use family planning to space their births further apart, instead of having them one straight after the other. Child health and survival improves, and women's health improves as well, with fewer children to take care of. The children get more of the available resources, women are freed up for employment, and economic benefits derive from that as well. So family planning leads to early benefits for maternal and child health. It changes the social and economic position of women, and it brings long-term economic benefits as well. Okay. At the start of this century, I mentioned the Millennium Development Goals. This really set the agenda till 2015, which actually is not very far away. This was about reducing poverty, it was about primary education, promoting gender equality, improving child health and maternal health, reducing malaria, HIV, other diseases. It was about environmental sustainability and global partnerships. And as I said, family planning, although it impacts on virtually all of these goals, didn't actually appear until 2007, when this goal was added, universal access to reproductive health. The Millennium Development Goals have undoubtedly been a powerful focus for global development. And much has been achieved. So some of the headlines here, child death rates have fallen by 40%, and there's been lots of achievement in malaria in particular and other infectious diseases. But not all the MDGs will be met by 2015, and things like maternal mortality and education lag behind. But of course, it's really hard to keep up with the pace of change, because there are now 1 billion more people than there were in 2000. So you've got to kind of keep running fast just to keep up. For example, you know, things have changed so much, there are now 6 billion mobile phone subscriptions compared with 1 billion when the MDG started. We can say that overall people are healthier, wealthier and better educated, but the poorest 1.2 billion account for only 1% of consumption, and the richest billion consume 72%. So there are still these vast inequalities. The main causes of death have changed because the world has got older, as I was showing before, and so disease burden is much more about chronic diseases like heart disease and cancer and obesity rather than the infectious diseases. So how has UCL responded to this? Well, I was one of many colleagues who got involved in the UCL Lancet Commission on climate change a few years back, and at that time climate change was all about the physical effects, and the Stern report on the economic effects was quite new then, and Al Gore's film, An Inconvenient Truth, and so on. But we felt that the health impacts had been a bit neglected, so we had this commission. And during that time, we also felt that population had been a bit neglected in the climate change debates. So after that, we had we got funding from Leverhulme to set up this symposium and brought a lot of people together to debate these issues. And that gave rise to a paper which we published in the Lancet earlier this year, which is really the basis of this talk. Okay. And in that paper, we plot some of these events on a timeline. I know this is not to be read, but green is the population events, red is to do with development, and blue, climate change. And it includes many of the things that I've been mentioning so far. So to return to the title and sum up in the last couple of slides, global growth versus human health, finding the balance, conjures up this sort of picture of a weighing scale, but it's clearly not like that. In this diagram, I've tried to capture some of the complexities and also the certainties involved. So we have our friend at the centre here, in the driving seat, is the demographic transition and the fundamental forces that have shaped and continue to shape modern society. The engine of the transition is switched on intellectually by the Age of Enlightenment and literally through the Industrial Revolution, which make possible and necessary the changes in public health and improvement in survival, which then triggers, sets the transition in motion. Consumption of fossil fuels and environmental resources leads to great economic growth, but it also causes climate change. And the transition itself leads to huge population growth. Global fertility is continuing to fall, but in countries where it's still high, like principally Africa, the rate of fall of fertility is going to have a huge effect on final population size and whether those countries can meet the MDGs and bring people out of poverty. What the effect of that fall in fertility will be on carbon emissions is less clear, because it's not simply about the number of people. It's consumers that cause climate change rather than people. So factors like population, aging, urbanization, and so on will also have an effect. And we don't know very much about what those individual net impacts are. The little bit of research that has been done suggests that providing family planning to all women would lead to a substantial reduction in carbon emissions. And how this whole transition plays out is affected by these kind of positive factors, education, family planning, employment systems, and so on, which were largely responsible for the Asian tiger economies developing so well in their part of the transition. There are huge implications for the aging population on human health and demand for healthcare and social care and so on. But also we know that these climate change and loss of biodiversity is continuing, and if that's coupled with water shortages and food insecurity, then there is the real possibility of bleak Malthusian-like scenarios where more and more people cannot have their basic needs met. So what can we do about this in two slides? Well, it seems to me that we need a second Age of Enlightenment that would guide us in different ways to think about how we deal with all this. There's no shortage of organisations, declarations and so on urging us what to do. And they mainly now reinforce the message about the need to reduce both consumption and population growth. It's not either or. Because of all these interconnections, bringing people together from different disciplines and communities and so on to find solutions makes sense, an obvious thing to do. And I've just put a couple of examples here. So population health and environment, so-called PHE projects, these aim to improve health and well-being of local populations while also preserving the critical ecosystems on which they depend. So for example, marine conservation projects coupled with family planning and so on in Madagascar and Philippines and Bangladesh have been very successful. Also, the benefits of health from reducing carbon emissions are substantial. So there's another win-win here. Walking and cycling reduces obesity, heart disease, and improves mental health and gets people out of cars, so that's good. Clean burning stoves reduce air pollutants by more efficient combustion, and that reduces the respiratory infections, particularly in children. And I'm referring here to some work from colleagues at the London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine who've tried to quantify these effects, these sort of win-win effects. It's clear that natural and social scientists need to intensify research on the interactions between consumption, demographic change, and environmental impact. So those things like aging and urbanization, how are they going to affect carbon dioxide emissions? And I referred here to this really excellent very expert but very readable report from the Royal Society called People and Planet. There are some encouraging signs. Recently, the UN General Assembly agreed to bring together these two frameworks for the Millennium Development Goals and the Sustainable Development Goals, which had been running on parallel tracks, rather strangely. So bringing them together around poverty alleviation and environmental sustainability makes a lot of sense. And possibly with the next meeting of COP, the Convention of the Parties, in December 2015, if that could achieve the same kind of merger around carbon emissions, because that's where the negotiations are made about reducing carbon emissions, then we might get to a more politically and scientifically integrated view on the future of the health of the planet. Okay, so for those of you who like a sort of short slogan or take-home message, I wouldn't recommend this one. Please don't try this at home. Placard said, save the planet, kill yourself. I think this one, which says, change the politics, not the climate, gets closer to the heart of how we choose to live our lives. Thank you.
Judith, thank you very much for a fascinating, fascinating talk. It's my job now just to chair about 5 minutes of questions and answers if anybody has any questions from the audience. There are microphones coming down, so if you just bear with us for a second.
I don't think we need many people for a developed economy. And maybe the only employable people are going to be those who can program computers to program other computers.
Computer takeover. Did people hear that question? No. The question was about the problem of employment for much greater numbers of working age people in the
especially in light of increasing automation and computerization.
Yeah. I think you're absolutely right, and I think that is certainly a major part of the sustainable development agenda, is how we manage to find how we try and get employment for those increasing numbers of working age population, which if we can get that right, as you saw in the Asian tiger economies, so called, that benefited from that big increase in young adults, and
you can have
but at the same time as also causing a lot more industrialization. So it's about finding ways that decouple those two. And you're right; it's one of the big challenges.
I'm just saying you can have an expanding economy without an expanding labor force. So no one's going to care about the tens of millions of very, very angry young men who have nothing to do except wave AK-47s.
Okay, thank you. Perhaps we could take another question.
Where do the ideas of James Lovelock fit in with you? And I'm thinking particularly, he said something like sustainable development is a sham. And we actually need to contract rather than go for sustainable development and growth.
Well, the contract and converge concept, I mean, I think that is there in the messages about reducing consumption and population growth at the same time. And if the imperative is to get to bring more billion poorest people out of poverty, then the imperative for richer countries to reduce their consumption. And so there's a kind of contract and converge in that. Yeah, I think that's correct. That's the implicit message.
Are there any alternatives other than genetically engineering new types of food that would deal with an increased need for food?
My understanding is that we are capable of producing enough food to feed 11 billion people or more, but that would be in a very different kind of world. And that if we were doing that, then we wouldn't have resources to maintain the kind of lifestyles that have been that we have in the West. So it is very much about this sort of making decisions about how we choose to live our lives and what kind of environment we want to live in. But simply food production, I think, is not the key limiting factor.
Time for one more question.
In Malaysia, there's sometimes pollution, and sometimes I have to wear a mask, I think.
She goes to the international school in Kuala Lumpur, and while we walk to school to save on pollution, often she has to wear a mask, and she wanted to share that.
Thank you for that, yes.
Okay, our time is done, I think. It just remains for me to once again thank Judith for a fascinating talk and to ask you to thank her in the normal way.